but you've been here for a couple of days. I don't know how you could have been and not had a really good time at this convention so far. And here at this facility, hotel, convention center, and a committee made up mostly of Augusta and Augusta surrounding counties folks have done a great job. Absolutely great. Say it again today. My little staff has done a great job too. Five folks have put this on. Pretty spectacular. Those of you that didn't hear me say this, and I may say it again today, because I like to say it, and I got the mic. Matt Purnell from the RNC was here for our state committee meeting on Thursday, and afterwards, Michael Welsh had given up. We'll talk about what all we were doing and what all was planned, how many different functions there were at this convention. He told me he had been to hundreds of conventions. His job was to represent the RNC with state parties. And that this convention had more opportunities for different things and different functions than any convention that he had ever been associated with or knew of. You did a great job, and thank you very much. We had a great banquet last night. I don't know how did the boot scoot party go last night. I was too worn out to get there. And but anyhow, if you didn't hear Carolyn Miller speech about the NRA, and you didn't have an opportunity to hear Governor Perdue last night, you missed something really special. And I'm sorry, those of you that were in this room know, I don't believe we could have squeezed, I'm not sure we got everybody seated to tell you the truth, but I don't know if we could squeeze hardly anybody else in here. We just ran out of space. Sorry, that's just what happened. Let me bring up to the stage Mike Welsh for our invocation. He's our 12th district chairman, and one of the main reasons that we're having such a good time here. Comes from Mike.
Let us pray. Oh, good and gracious God, we just thank you for this moment in time that you have called us all together here. Lord, may we be reminded at all times that it's not about us, but that you are a powerful and great God, and that through your great wisdom, you created a place called the United States of America. And through that great wisdom, you enabled us to rule ourselves through a great experiment. Lord, we just thank you for that experiment. We thank you that we are the recipients of your goodness and mercy, that we are certainly not able to understand and certainly not worthy of. Lord, you have blessed us with bounty beyond our imagination. We praise you for it. We thank you for your many blessings. Father, we thank you for this food that we're partaking. We pray for the rest of this day. May you be honored and glorified in all that we say and do. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'd like to call on Ron Johnson to come forward with a pledge, please. sitting at a table with a veteran offering a bottle of breakfast. We have with us today a couple of great Georgians. You know them both very well. I'm not going to spend a lot of time reintroducing them to you, except to say they're great friends of the party, they're great friends of yours as a Republican. We can't do business these days without either of them. They represent you and your values well. First up will be Lieutenant Governor Casey Cagle.
Well, thank you very much, John. It is a great honor to be here this morning, and I know that everyone has enjoyed their time just as much as I have, looking around and visiting with so many friends and individuals that have meant an awful lot to me over the years. I want to first just say to John, along with his staff, you all have done a wonderful, wonderful job putting on this convention, and we appreciate your wonderful leadership as well. Let's give it around. And I was here last night as well, and being able to see this room completely packed and to have Governor Perry present with us as well, and who gave a remarkable, remarkable call to action, a wonderful speech, and we appreciate his great leadership as well. You know, when I was coming in this morning, I was thinking about, the trip that all of us have been on as Republicans for decades. And I remember back when I first decided to run for the state senate, and that was some years ago. And I remember specifically going to my grandfather at that time. My grandfather I called Papa Bill. And I went to him and I said, you know, Papa Bill, I've got some really, really good news, and I also have some bad news. And he says, well, what's the good news? And I said, well, the good news is I'm going to run for the state senate. And he says, oh man, that is so great, that's so exciting. And he began to talk about all the people that he could get in touch with, touch base with, and how he could help. And then all of a sudden he just froze for a moment. And he said, well, what's the bad news? And I said, well, bad news is that I'm running as a Republican. And he froze, okay? He completely froze at that moment. And he looked at me with the most serious eyes, and even though he no longer is with me, I can tell you, I can still remember his face even to this day. And this is what he said: I have never voted for a Republican. Now, he never told me after that election and after I'd won that he voted for me, but he did let me put a yard sign up in his yard. So that was certainly a good sign. But it tells the story of this great journey that all of us have been a part of for so, so many years. And each of you have been steadfast in your commitment to the conservative principles. But more importantly, you just haven't talked the talk. You have also walked the walk. You have been there to make sure that in your communities all across the state, that yard signs are being put up, and phone banks are being occupied, individuals are being there to make sure that people understand the distinction. When I first ran, we really couldn't even talk almost about Republicans, so what we did is we said, vote conservative, vote Republican, showing that you don't want to be a liberal, and if you're a Democrat, you're a liberal. What we find ourselves today, though, is in a posture by which, when Republicans took the majority, both in the Senate, and we were able to have then Governor Perdue, we were able to not win outright, but we were able to have individuals come along with that journey to give us a majority. And we have been set on a course from that point forward to do things like making sure that we are fiscally responsible on how we balance the budget, setting the kind of public policies in place that allow the economy to continue to grow. We are so blessed in our state with so many wonderful assets. Assets like the busiest airport in the world, the fastest growing port, research institutions that are second to none, the capital of the South with an ecosystem that is so strong that people are fighting to get here. Our growth continues to look good, not just in terms of people, but also as it pertains to revenue. And we have to be good stewards. Sometimes when I think of being the Lieutenant Governor and I sit behind that podium, think about all the walls and all the activities that are going on. I am very, very humble. I'm humbled because sometimes on this journey, I never would have thought that I would have been that person to be the first Republican Lieutenant Governor. So many people have believed in me. They have given their resources and their times and committed to making that a reality. And I will forever be indebted. Nydia and I had something very, very special to happen in our life 8 months ago. We had our oldest son and his new wife give us our first grandbaby, a little girl. And her, absolutely, you can clap. A little girl, and her name is Everett Grace. And everyone told me, they said, Casey, you love your kids, but you fall in love with your grandkids. Now let me just tell you, I fell head over heels with that pretty little girl. And I got to see her yesterday before I came down. And when I look into those eyes, I see something very, very special. And what it does is it gives me a greater motivation to be steadfast in our commitment to where we are providing a future that is bright and filled with hope and prosperity, not just for my granddaughter, but for everyone else that is out there. I sit around and I look and I see that 1 in 5 of our people are still in poverty. There's more prosperity, there's more opportunity that can be created. And we in government, although we don't create jobs, private sector is the one that creates jobs. We create the environment by which jobs can be created, people can thrive. And that is our commitment as a state, to continue to be a pro-business state, a state where individuals can risk their capital and create jobs where people can experience the American dream. Secondly, we also have an educational system that has to improve. Sadly enough, I can take you to communities today across the state. If they have a poor educational system, they're not experiencing the growth in which they need. We can't have a top-down style of management. We don't need Washington, D.C. trying to tell us how to educate our kids. What we need are individuals and communities that are free to design an educational curriculum that meets the need not only of their community, but ultimately meets the need of the individual student. You see, in education, I don't believe in just simply going through motions. I believe in a vision of education that has a floor, but in that floor, there are no cracks by which individuals are able to fall between. But there is also no ceiling. Every child has the ability to go as far, as high as they can possibly dream. That's what America is founded upon. And we've got to give that foundation because education drives the economy. And when we commit ourselves to that, those are the things that are going to make a difference. What I will tell you in closing is that we are standing in a place in time in history that I believe is the biggest time that probably for most of us we have witnessed. And some may say that, you know, well, I'm not crazy about presidential choices. Some may bring up a whole host of different thoughts. Well, guess what? I don't agree with my wife on everything, and she doesn't agree with me on everything. But we love each other, and we are committed to one. No different than each of us in this room are committed to the conservative principles that we hold dear, that define who we are. this race is less about personality and less about people. It is more about who is going to be the next Supreme Court Justice of this country. Ladies and gentlemen, that's not going to just impact us for a year or two. It's going to impact us for decades to come. That is the fight. And that is the very reason by which we have to be more motivated and more challenged than we have ever been in our lifetimes. We should be out pursuing and being perseverant in our effort to ensure that we do all we can to influence the people in our state, but also across the country. Because I'm telling you, Hillary Clinton is not what this country needs. We got to do our part. Thank you.
Saved you a ton of money.
And he said, well, yeah, I guess you did. I said, well, how about tipping us and send us a few $100,000 of it back down there? And he said, I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman, I already sent it to Louisiana. David Perdue is already one of the premier senators in Washington. He has done a great job. I think we will have to all admit that. And we're going to enjoy him today. And then in a couple of years, we're going to send him back up there again. Let me introduce to you Senator David Perdue.
People that put on these things, you don't think about it, but it's amazing what goes into this, and I'm very honored to be here today. I'm so impressed to sit by Lieutenant Governor Cagle, and I see all these elected officials in here, but as well as being impressed and honored to sit next to these guys, I'm honored to be in the same room with you guys. We made a difference. I'm going to tell that story from my perspective, because that's absolutely the truth. And I'll give you the real numbers too, and it's bigger than a few $100,000 I should have tipped you. The governor said, he talked to his relatives and said, I got good news and bad news. I had exactly the same conversation when Bonnie and I prayerfully decided to do this 3 years ago in probably March of 2013. I went to my mother. Now, my mother's 90, was 87, she just turned 90. And if you've ever met my mother, and some of you have, what's in her head comes out of her mouth. There's not much of a filter. I love her to death, but you never know what you're going to get. So I said, Mom, I got good news and bad news, just like the governor. She says, oh, really? What's the good news? I said, the good news, Bonnie and I decided to run for the United States Senate. She said, what? And I said, I got bad news. Bonnie and I decided to run for the United States Senate. And she looked at me like I'd lost my mind, and she sat there for a minute, and she said, yep, I can see you can do that. She got on the phone, got on the computer, and went to work, and 2 years later, we were very fortunate to win, thanks to you guys. But later in the process, I got a call. Now, David Axelrod, when the Democrats really thought they could reach in here and steal this Senate race, David Axelrod was running the nun race. Now, Axelrod, you may remember, did all those nasty ads about Romney back in 12, right? The little lady with the oxygen up the nose and all this sort of stuff. And he came down here, and they had $45 million to lay on us, and it was bad. It hurt. You know that. And my mom called me one day in probably September. She said, David, I love you like a son. I said, Mom, I am your son. She said, yeah, but I'm not sure, when we talk out here in public, that I'm really going to claim you. She said, I've been watching these ads, David. He said, I love you like a son, but if these Democrats keep up, I'm not sure I'm even going to vote for you. So it was a nasty, nasty thing. I'm going to tell the story that John mentioned just now. It's absolutely the truth. A couple of my guys that were advising, Paul Beneke specifically, and I went to Washington when we became the nominee. This was almost immediately, right after we became the nominee, and went to Washington, and the NRSC there called us in and said, our polls say you're down 3-5%. You're not running a very good race. You're lucky to be here. But we're going to calm down after the election. You won't win in the election. We've got the numbers. We know how all this works out. And in the meantime, what we want you to do is save your money and wait till the runoff. And then we'll come down there. We're going to pull the money we were going to send to Georgia, but we're going to send it to North Carolina, Iowa, and Louisiana. Now, we won all those races less than 2 points. So it was a godsend that they actually pulled that money out and made a difference in those races. At the same time, the Democrats said, oh, wow, we see what they're doing, and they poured money in and doubled down on Georgia because they believed the national poll numbers that say we were down 5-7%. This is 6 weeks out now. We went to Washington and later and said, and they told us, we're going to come back and we'll help you. And what John didn't tell you, it would have been January the 6th would have been the primary runoff day. January, I will never forget that. That's the day that they swore in all the other guys that got elected, right? Well, they told us it could have been $100 million that would have been spent in that runoff in that 9 weeks now, $100 million. And we spent, as a total, this is how crazy, is $75 million in this race, just getting through the runoff and the primary. And the Democrats really thought they were going to do it. And we got to the floor, we got on the steps of the building up there where we were meeting. I looked at Paul and he looked at me and we just shook our heads and said, no, I don't believe it. We had an internal pollster who happened to be one of the current presidential candidates' pollsters, but we didn't know that back then. And he said, we called him. He said, do you really believe your numbers? He said, yeah, we believe the numbers. Because in May of 13, he said, if we have one message, and that's this, if we had that message, and it came right out of my heart. He said, look, we got a mess. We got a lot of people in Washington that are out of touch. They've been there a long time. If they were going to make a difference when they've done already. And then we got on the Democrats and the failed Democrats. And he said, if you stay on that message and don't get off track, you can win this thing in the fall. So we doubled down. We came back, went to work. And because a lot of people in this room, we beat the Democrats. And they thought they were going to steal this thing. Sam Nunn told me that the night of the election, they thought they were going to win by five or six points. And we won by a little over 8 points. So the pollsters missed this thing down here by almost 13, 14 points. And it was because of you guys. And I'm telling you, we have an opportunity right now that I'm really standing here. I got chill bumps right now. I'm excited because, and I wasn't that way. Bonnie will tell you, a month ago I was agonizing over this thing. I couldn't see anybody stepping out that was going to be capable of beating Hillary Clinton. Well, Hillary Clinton keeps setting the table for us. She goes to Pennsylvania and says, I'm going to kill all you guys in the coal patch. And all you coal miners, I'm going to put out of work. And all your coal mines, we're going to put you out of business. Wait a minute. She's standing in a coal mine town saying that. We've got a candidate right now that is an outsider. I'm going to talk about that in the next hour. I'm very excited. We have we have a candidate that is a real, he's an outsider too. All right, I got it. It takes more than no one, really. You watch how many people in the next cycle are going to say, yeah, I'm an outsider, all right. I'm new to this, and I'm humble because I didn't know what I was getting into. I didn't know how much work it was. I really didn't know how you got people to vote for you. And then I watched all you guys because you weren't new to it. You were veterans. Most people who voted don't know who you are, but you made the difference. And we have that opportunity right now. But let's look back at 08 and 2012 where we had similar opportunities. In 08, I get it, it was a wave, people voted against Bush, I understand that. 2012, I just don't understand. After 4 years of failure, our country reelected a president who had failed. Well, now we got 8 years, and we've got a mess. Georgia's so blessed because we've had great leadership over the last 15 years or so that makes Georgia the number one state in the country in which to do business. That's not me talking, that's all the business periodicals out there that evaluate these states. I was in California just 2-3 weeks ago. I had a chance to meet several of the movie studio CEOs out there. And we were talking about it. They're doing more movies now in Georgia. Most of the studios are doing more movies in Georgia this year than they are in California. And it's all going to grow. We continue to make Georgia economic friendly, job friendly. Imagine what would happen if we had somebody in the White House who knew how to do that. I'm not going to speak for very long this morning. I'm going to lay the wood to you this afternoon, later this morning, because I am absolutely convinced we're at a crossroads in America. And it's up to us. This is not up to Hillary Clinton. I don't care what she says. I don't care what she does. I don't care how much money they raise by the billionaires in California. This is our time. We can win this thing this fall with a guy who can absolutely change the direction of our country. I know in this convention, we're going to do what we should do. We're going to talk about rules. We're going to talk about platform. We're going to send delegates. I get all that. And there's going to be controversy in this room today. But when we walk out of here tonight, we have got to be 100% locked up together on one thing. That one thing, why are you doing this? If we have a cup of coffee and we talk about it, when it comes down to why you do what you're doing and why Bonnie and I did what we're doing, why the governor does, why John, all you guys, why we do what we're doing, we want to change the direction of the country. We want to change the direction of the country. It's not, I need to do this and I need to do that. No. Our kids and grandkids, the governor talks about his granddaughter. I've got a grandson I want to introduce to her in about 15 years. We have the opportunity to not be a member of the first generation that has to tell our kids if we're leaving the world on its worst. So think about that opportunity. When you start getting mad about, well, I'm not getting my way, or they don't agree with me, or I don't agree with that, or I don't like what he said, and I don't like the color of his hair, I sure don't like that comb over, and all of this sort of stuff, get over it. We can win this thing. Let's go.
thank you, folks. Thank you for being here. Just about to fill up this room for breakfast this morning. That's great. I know it's tough getting up 6 o'clock to get here at 7:30. We'll gavel in at 10 today. Please try to be in or around your seats when we start about 10. And we look forward to having a great afternoon and visiting with you this morning. Thank you. God bless you.